In this video, we will go through best practice draft-proofing houses using plasterboard as the air barrier in a standard 90mm stud frame brick fitting home. Air tightness is critical to energy efficiency and comfort. And with these tips, you can aim for an air tightness level of 6 cubic metres per hour at 50 Pascal, even lower, which can cut down drafts by up to 60%. Getting outdoor air from mouldy wall cavities is not fresh air at all. I'm here with Joseph, who's an expert in the air tightness aspect of buildings and especially homes. So as in video one, we spoke all about insulation. We've mentioned that we use the plasterboard, the internal plasterboard of the building, as our air tightness layer to achieve a draft proof building at 6 cubic meters per hour per square meter at 50 Pascal.
All that we are talking about is just how to create a continuous air barrier so that draft can be minimized.
So, okay, Joseph, let's look at it in a bit more detail. Specifically, the major details are the junction at the floor, internal, external corners, the corners, be it a cornice or square set commonly, and even bulkheads. Give us a bit of an overview of the strategy.
The good news for the plasterers is there's nothing too difficult for you to do. For all the corners, internal, externals, or the square set to the ceiling, it's just conventional practice. Just make sure you do it nicely, and when it looks good, it's airtight. For the junction to the floor, you want to seal it before you install the skirting board. And the way to do it is usually because we having some unevenness on the floor slab, so we typically would recommend an 8mm gap. When you're lifting the plasterboard, you use some 8mm packers to hold it in place. Then after you fix the plasterboard, all you need to do is to use a 10mm backing rod to stuff that in. Then you can use caulking to mastic seal the joint. And you will use the same techniques to deal with the ceiling junction if you're installing conexes.
Again, it's a lot of sort of masticking, but of course backing rods are obviously useful.
And the good news is, because we are going to install skirting board or conexes on top of it, so it doesn't need to be a very nice job.
Little question about bulkheads, because there's a really important point to be made.
Well, for bulkheads, practically what you need to do is you need to fully encase the bulkheads with plasterboard, regardless of there will be hanging cabinetry underneath it. Because it is very common when there is cabinetry or joinery installed, the plasterer don't seal it with plasterboard because it's going to have the cabinet there anyway. But when we talk about air tightness, if you don't seal it with plasterboard, the gap between the joinery or the cabinetry and the frame would become a major source of draft that all your heating or cooling will lose.
Joseph, we've moved across to a little mock-up of a return air conditioning system. It's not exactly typical because you're going to explain what needs to happen to achieve a level of air tightness, knowing that we know that these return airs leak like a sieve.
This is very much one of the worst part in your house when we are talking about draft proofing. Believe it or not, the top of it is very typical, as shown here. Nothing on top of it to cap it off. The installer is just drop a flexi duct into it, and voila, there's their return air plenum. Also, the size, they usually encapsulated with the interior plasterboard. Of course, we can air seal that by masticking it, or the junction from the inside to the plasterboard, but believe it or not, it will cut your work by more than half by lining the interior. Because when you look into it, you will see if you line the interior, all you have to seal is just one junction along the two back corners. And then for this side, close to the front, you just seal that plasterboard to the stud frame. And then all you need to do after that is, before you install your final piece of plasterboard, put a bit of caulking there, and then you install your final piece of plasterboard. Then you got an airtight seal on all four sides. And for the top, always have a cutout capping. So you put a bit of caulking before you screw down this final piece. And then the mechanical installer can have their ductwork attached to it.
So this spigot goes on top. So actually, this is not common practice, that now your flexible duct hooks onto a spigot, the spigot sealed to the cap, the cap sealed to the framing. We've got internal lining, all mastic and cork, top, bottom, very much like our internal plasterboard.
Exactly.
Treat this like internal plasterboard. Mastic it at the cornice, the mm-hmm. floor, the internal corners, all that sort of stuff. And all of a sudden, we've got a sealed unit. Now,
yep.
It's not common to see it done this way.
No. It's way easier to do it this way than you try to do the conventional way and try to find all the nitty-gritty junction inside. Mm-hmm. Because I can guarantee you, you will miss at least 20% of those gaps.
It seems reasonably straightforward, doesn't it?
Yep.
I'm going to say I don't know reason why this can't be done every time.
Well, the only reason is most trade don't know they need to do it.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly.
Or the benefit of doing it.
Yep. So unfortunately, when the air tightness audit and the test is carried out and we're not hitting the target, unfortunately, we're just going to walk straight over to the return air.
Yep.
And we're going to see what's happened inside.
Yep.
And that's going to be a potential area of failure.
If it is not sealed, half of the conditioned air is not returned to the system at all. It just go out to the roof.
Okay, Joseph, we've got a lovely double glazed PVC locally made window in front of us. Just give us the overview of sealing up doors and windows.
Well, doors and window, the treatment is virtually the same. All we need to focus on is this gap between the reveal and the stud frame. Traditionally, most people, when they're doing with draft proofing, they are just dealing with the architrave around and seal caulking on both sides. While that may give you good result for the first 6 months to a year, because they are so thin, those seals can easily be broken with time and slight movement around. That's why if we want to do it properly, have long-lasting results, we have to deal with the gap here.
So Joseph, are we playing with backing rod and caulking?
Well, it really depends on how the window installer is doing, but most likely we are dealing with a gap more than 15 mil. Mm-hmm. And it's not ideal to use caulking when you have a gap larger than 15 mil. So what do? We use a product called expander foam, but you can't use any expander foam because the window is not as strong in a sense, or it's very restrictive, the gap. If you use ordinary expander foam, you are running in the risk of that have a too much of force when it expanding and bulk this reveal. So we always recommend we put some backing rod towards the outside of the stud frame, and then we use a low expansion flexible foam to fill this gap. Then you can both have the performance of air seal as well as it provide insulation as well.
Right.
Two birds with one stone, why not?
So we've got the window installer putting a backing rod in from the outside, and we've got expanding foam, low expansion foam filling up the inside.
Yep.
I've seen it expand out, so there's always the necessity once it has sort of set or dried.
And you trim it.
Trim it off.
Yep.
Simple.
And then it's just conventional plasterboard on, and then architrave on, and then the painter can do their finishing caulking as they like. Okay, now come to my favorite, internal cavity sliding doors. Why is it my favorite? Because this internal cavity sliding door can leak huge volume of air, because when the piece of door going in and out, you got big gap on both sides. And typically when the plasterboard being installed, it's not really flush to this frame, and it create a big gap. Air can go around to the side, to the other part of the wall, or go directly to the roof. to deal with that, we need to create an encapsulation. To do it is not too hard. First, you need to identify which part of the stud frame forms the pocket housing this sliding door. Step number two, use caulking mastic to seal the junction of this pocket of stud frame, both top and bottom. And then this is the interesting part. We use low profile memory foam strip. Typically you'd use that for door and window sills to create a gasket all around this pocket. So when you install your plasterboard, it creates a compression seal all around. All the plasterer needs to do is ensure you got plaster screw to have pressure all around this pocket.
Air tightness is critical for healthy and energy efficient homes. To learn more about best practice for install of insulation, watch video one of this series. And for tips on air tightness and insulation during practical completion stage of construction, watch video three.